So the first one was relying on the modulation of the ground state light shift, leading to this dipole forces and to the so-called Sisyphus effect, which occurs if you have lean Perpling polarizations. And the second one is related to an atomic motion-induced population difference between atomic ground states, which leads to imbalanced radiation pressure. And this was what one has in this sigma plus, sigma minus polarization configuration. In both cases, the limit temperature is of order of the recoil energy. And the next question is, can one beat this limit? So we saw somewhat how this could be done in this example of this transparency beam that would put the atoms out of resonance and protect them from scattering photons. Suppression of the scattering rate is actually position dependent. But can we find mechanisms where this photon absorption rate would be velocity dependent, so would be zero for atoms sufficiently slow at zero velocity? And these are three different laser cooling mechanisms that do that somewhat, which we will discuss today. The first one is this VSCPT cooling, velocity selective population trapping, coherent population trapping. Second one is Raman cooling, and an extension to Raman sideband cooling in optical lattices. And the last one is related is the so-called gray molasses. So let's start with this VSCPT cooling mechanism. We consider an atom which has a lambda-shaped level structure, okay? And a coupling through two different laser fields, E1, E2, that respectively couple G1 to the unexcited state and G2 to the same excited state. With Rabi frequencies that can be different, omega 1, omega 2, and those two states can also be at different energy states, different level of energy. We will show that in such a configuration, there is actually a dark state that is uncoupled to the light field, and this dark state is actually a superposition of those two ground states. Okay, so you can build a superposition of those two states that is not coupled to the light. And from that state, that means that the excitation to the excited state is not possible, and this arises from destructive interference from the two amplitudes of transition that bring the system to the excited state. So we will start with a somewhat simpler case where we will consider the two ground states. We will take two ground states that are actually degenerate. So we shine two laser fields which are counterpropagating with opposite circular polarization. And an example of such a lambda system would be G1 and G2 are the two Zeeman substates of a certain ground state, m equal minus 1 and plus 1, while E will be an m equal 0 state. Okay. So you see that this laser being sigma plus couples minus 1 to 0, this one being minus couples plus 1 to 0. Okay. So we can write the atom laser coupling by summing the dipolar interaction through the two different electric fields. And we end up with this expression where we have this coupling with the Rabi frequency omega 1. That couples E to G1, from G1 to E, and the coupling with omega 2 that couples G2 to E. So since the two waves that we have are counterpropagating, they are actually, their phase dependence are given by kz with opposite values, minus kz for phi 1, plus kz for phi 2. So this is what interaction potential looks like in the end. So if we consider an atom which is at rest at a position z, and if we look at the superposition state, which is a superposition of the state G1 and G2 with those phases that are actually spatially dependent, okay, and with those weights that are given by the Rabi frequency, you can see that if you calculate this scalar, this state somehow, that you find zero, okay? So this acts on that, and you see that this minus kz kills the plus kz. This omega 1, omega 2 is what is in front, and this one kills this, the plus kz kills the minus kz, and this omega 1 multiplies by omega 2, and you have this minus term, and in the end the coupling is zero, okay? So this state is the dark state I mentioned, okay? And if you have an atom which is in this state in the light field, it's not coupled to the light field, it stays there forever. But note that this is for the atom at rest, but if the atom is not at rest, those two waves that we have will be somewhat Doppler shifted in opposite direction, and the two amplitudes of transition do not interfere anymore. So here we have a dark state for an atom which is not moving, but this dark state will not remain dark when the atom moves. We will see that in more detail in the next slides. So we are interested in trying to describe laser cooling methods that go below the recoil limit. So we have to do quantum mechanical treatment of the atom position and momentum. Okay, so we shall consider the laser phases phi 1, phi 2, and thus z as operators. And if I use this relation of closure, develop exponential plus or minus kz on the coupling to the different momenta in the momentum of the in the basis of the momentum, the coupling will write like this. Okay, so a sum over the momentum of couplings through one that couple g1 to e. An atom initially in p minus h bar k absorb a photon h bar k, goes to the momentum p, and it's opposite for the overbeam that goes in the other direction. So you see that here the laser field actually induces coupling between momenta states, but in a momentum family in which the evolution happens, and those families are somewhat closed. And EP is coupled to G1 P minus H bar K and to G2 P plus H bar K. And if I am in this family, these are the states in which the evolution, the coupling of the through the laser field will make that I will have to leave somehow. And as long as we ignore spontaneous emission, this is a closed family of states. Okay? If I look at things in each family state independently, pretty much like what I did before, when I had those phases which were z-dependent, I can construct a state which is not coupled, which will be now given by this expression, where you see that the state in G1 has a weight which is related to the Rabi frequency of the other beam, but this state has a momentum which is p minus h bar k, for the other state, the weight is given by the Rabi frequency of the first beam with a momentum p plus h bar k. Very much like what I did before, if you take the potential that I wrote before, decomposed over the momentum basis, and you calculate what is this matrix element, you find zero, which shows that this state is actually dark. You have also an orthogonal state to this dark state that you can construct, and this one being dark, this one is actually coupled to the state, and this is the coupling you get when you calculate this matrix element to the excited state. So we can build in this family of states a state which is not coupled to the light, and another one which will be coupled to the light. So now, Let's assume that we have prepared an atom in the state, which is this non-coupled state, and let's see how it evolves, okay? If I just consider the evolution in this family state, I have to add to this laser coupling the free Hamiltonian of the atom, which contains the kinetic energy and the internal energy, okay? Okay. I give you a reference of where those things can be calculated. The idea would be is to calculate what is the evolution of the population in this dark state, okay? And this is done in this paper using the formalism of the density matrix And what is important is that one finds that the evolution of this population in this dark state is actually given by the evolution of this matrix element, okay? And you see that it is proportional to the momentum, okay? This is what is important. And there is also this matrix element that one has to calculate somehow. But what does that mean? That means that if the velocity, if the momentum is zero, so I am in this family of states, E0, G1 minus h bar k, G2 plus h bar k, the population, if I have atoms in this dark state, which will be psi non-coupled zero, it does not evolve, okay? So it remains a dark state, even if I consider the free evolution and adding the evolution with the kinetic energy, okay? And one can show that it still holds if I take into account spontaneous emission, because this is a superposition of ground states, okay? So spontaneous emission does not do anything on that. So this thing is really a dark state which does not evolve. But when the momentum is not zero, okay, it will evolve, so this population changes over time, which tells that atom leave the dark state because of the coupling, and this coupling is actually induced by the kinetic energy. Okay, and this comes from the fact that kinetic energy of those two states differ by this amount, and that's what makes that we have this residual coupling. In the calculation of the interference of the amplitude to construct the destructive interference, the fact that those two states differ in their kinetic energy makes that this interference, which is destructive, is not destructive anymore. So this mechanism, which is called coherent population trapping, depends on the momentum, okay? And so it is actually velocity selective. So this is something we were looking for. We want to find a way to put the atom in a dark state where if they are at zero velocity, they do not scatter photon anymore, okay? This is exactly what we have here. So let's look a little bit to what the role of spontaneous emission is. So I consider here resonant excitation. So the two light beams are actually set on resonance with the excited state. And in the limit of weak excitation, we saw that there was a coupling between this coupled state and the excited state, which is given by this Rabi coupling, if the two couplings from the two waves are taken identical, okay? And this will give to this coupled state a finite width, which I can calculate as gamma over 2 times the saturation parameter, which is related to the, in the limit where I am at resonance, to the Rabi frequency squared divided by gamma squared, okay? So this is the finite width that this coupled state acquires due to spontaneous emission. This coupled state also couples to the non-coupled state if P is not zero, okay, with this coupling, which is Kp over M. And this gives, pretty much like here, a finite width to this non-coupled state if P is not zero, which I can write, following this, as the coupling square divided by the finite width of the coupled state, okay? So you see that the finite width of this non-coupled state, which is at non-zero momentum, depends on the momentum to the square, okay? So this is basically the probability per unit time for an atom to actually leave this non-coupled state. So you see that the smaller the momentum, the longer the atom stays trapped in the dark state, okay? And eventually, given the interaction time theta, but only atoms with p such that this is smaller than 1, okay, which corresponds to that, will remain trapped during this time in this in this somewhat dark state. So spontaneous emission does also somewhat allow that when the atom would jump from one momentum family to another. Yes? No, it's a continuous wave, but you shine it on for a certain time, okay? So given, so if you have atoms in this state, for that time, given that you have this decay, but if you obey this, then basically the atoms are still in the dark state. That's only what it means, okay? We will see later what is the importance of this interaction time in the VSCPT pooling mechanism. Okay, so spontaneous emission, I was saying, allows that I basically leave this family of state, because when I do random scattering, I gain momentum in any kind of direction, and here it's a 1D, but so you imagine that there is no reason that I will remain in this momentum family state, as I will have a small projection along the direction in which, in this 1D direction in which I'm working, where the momentum transfer would make that I would leave the family, okay? But the good thing is that it means that if you are in a family which has a non-zero momentum state, there is a chance that you fall into the one where you have this dark state, really dark, with a momentum which is zero. And if so, the atom may be trapped in this real super dark state, okay, where there is no coupling to the light. So the mechanism for accumulating the trapped state is actually related to the diffusion in momentum space that is induced by spontaneous emission. So it's like some kind of random process. You have to be lucky that some atoms fall there. Okay, falling into the P equals zero family is not enough, because you might fall in this state or in that state, not necessarily in any linear combination of these, and not necessarily into the good linear combination that makes that you are in the non-coupled state, okay? Okay, so is it really detrimental? Well, imagine that my atom falls, for instance, into this family, but in this state, which is G1 minus H bar K, which is only like half leg, somewhat coupled and uncoupled, okay? This is what I wrote here. This state is actually a superposition of the non-coupled and the coupled states. And this is a simple superposition here if I assume that the couplings are identical. So this state is stable, not this one, which means that it will be excited, and there will be a probability for this to go to this coupled state, okay, and to be excited by the laser. So if you wait enough with respect to the time corresponding to this excitation rate, you will find the atom either in the non-coupled state, where you will remain trapped, or it will be somewhat evolving and undergoing new fluorescence cycles that may, by chance, bring it also to the non-coupled state, and so on. So this is a state filtering process that basically will leave half of the atom in the trapped state, while the other half will undergo again new fluorescence cycles, and after some time, a fraction of this will fall into the dark state, and so on and so on. So you see that atoms will get accumulated into this dark state with time. So this is a numerical simulation of the time evolution of the momentum distribution if you apply this VSCPT cooling, and here you increase the time. So you start with a Gaussian momentum distribution, which has an half width half max of, say, 3 H bar K, okay? And you let this VSCPT cooling beam on for some time, and you increase the time. And what you see is that you accumulate atoms in those. So this dark state is a superposition of those two momenta state, okay? So if you look in the momentum distribution, you have those two peaks. And you see that the number of atoms that is transferred into these two peaks increases with time. And also, interesting, is that the width of those peaks gets narrower, okay, with time. And here we have some kind of, we have a double peak distribution, but each peak is subrecoil, okay? With, you see, momentum width that can be well below the recoil limit. Interesting is that here this was a picture of what I would get if I would use identical coupling for the two waves. But if I do take two different couplings, this dark state is somewhat imbalanced, okay? and has more weight on one state with respect to the other, so that the velocity distribution would look like an unbalanced double peak distribution. Okay. And another interesting thing is that this VSCPT mechanism, so which we derived and looked at things assuming that the lasers are resonant and we are exactly tuned on the transition and so, it works even if the lasers are detuned and does not depend on the sign of the detuning. It can be blue detuned, red detuned, whatever. I still have this mechanism of accumulation in the dark state. So this was first demonstrated in the late 80s, okay, at the ENS with an experiment which was manipulating metastable helium, which has a nice J equal 1 to 1 transition, which is a good model for this lambda transition. And so you have a beam, beam source of atom, and here it was 1D, so you had a laser which was perpendicular with the wave plates to prepare the proper polarizations. And they would look at the distribution after some time with a detector which is sensitive in position. It's an electron multiplier. So metastable helium atom, you remember, they carry a lot of internal energy. Whenever they knock a surface, they get ionized and they emit an electron. So you can detect them very easily by multiplying this electron and having an electronic detection. And this is what was used. And you can scan this across the beam. And what they could see is that starting with a beam like this, they could see the double peak distribution with those sub-recoil widths. And this was refined with colder atoms and a MOT, but then only still 1D, so not in a beam, but in a MOT. And they demonstrated temperature as low as the recoil temperature divided by 800, okay? So it's really a super sub-recoil temperature. And this is in this paper, and actually did this measurement of such a low temperature, not directly by looking at the expansion of the cloud, which is peanuts, and too small to be different from the initial size of the cloud. So no way that you can measure the temperature. And they use actually an interferometric method based on splitting and overlapping the wave packet, having a delay, and then the overlap would depend on the temperature, and with that they could estimate this ultra-low temperature. If you want details, you can look at this nice paper. This was extended to 2D. Well, I can construct a dark state if I have those two sigma plus, sigma minus waves counterpropagating. If I put four, I have a dark state which is a superposition of four states which have different momenta in the four directions. So here, the experiment was such that still with this metastable helium atom, you start with a MOT or so. And to detect them, you let them fall onto this nice detector, which is actually position dependent. Okay, so the atom knock here, emits an electron, and amplify, you amplify it, and you can detect it selectively in the position. And you have a picture here of the impact of the atoms on the detector after this VSCPT, and it's very clear that one sees four peaks, okay, at the velocities, and then you calibrate everything, and you can really check that this is indeed plus or minus V recoil, plus or minus V-recoil in the two directions, with somewhat sub-recoil widths of VR over 4. This is what it looks like if you make a nice picture with colors. A very interesting thing with this mechanism, which we saw, when I unbalance the intensity in the different beams, I can basically imbalance the weight that I have in the different momenta state. Okay, so You can switch slowly, so just such that the process is adiabatic, okay, free of the beam and keep only one. And what happens is that you transfer all the atoms in one of those four sub-recoil peaks. Okay? So it's really sub-recoil with this only plus VR along one of the directions and with a sub-recoil width. Isn't that neat? No? That's great. You see, you manipulate, yes? I don't remember exactly, but you know, you have to be, it's related to the time it takes for the dark state to build somehow, okay? And you want to be slow comparison to this time. This process is actually related to the spontaneous emission rate. And you see that it's a process which is a little bit random. So it takes a right mini cycle somehow that you reach the state, but this will be the order of magnitude. But this is a time that is like, I don't remember, but I don't want to say stupid things, but it's sufficiently short that you see that the atom stays in the beam if you have a mot. Okay, it's not like tens of seconds or seconds or whatever, it's like millisecond scale or whatever. This would be enough. And then this was extended to 3D. Well, you just have to put six beams. Huh? They chose to have two beams in the horizontal direction and four others at 45 degrees. The reason is that then they could discriminate the time of arrival in the detector for the different projection of the velocity. Would they have them all in the same plane? They could not make the difference. Well, it has to be selective in position and in time. So here it's selective in position and in time. So they look at different times and they see the arrival of the pair that for which they expect that it comes at that time. Okay. So one can also do quantum Monte Carlo simulation to study what happens somehow in time while the interaction time increases. And this random work that the atom does in the momentum space is actually dominated by rare events where the atom will stay for a very long time in zero momentum, okay? So in this trap state. And the distribution of such trapping times, if I look at the distribution in trapping time in a small volume around p equals 0, scales like 1 over tau to the power 3 half at 1d, where tau is the interaction time. This is interesting because with such a time distribution, the average time that the atom stays in 0 diverges. Okay? So you have a very peculiar here statistics. So you can use specific tools called Levy statistics to deal with such fancy peculiar distribution. And using this analysis, this statistical tools, one can show that the temperature actually scales like the inverse of the interaction time. And that the momentum distribution will be Lorentzian-like rather than Gaussian. Okay? And this is really related to this Levy flights. Okay? Atoms stay for a very long time in the p state 0, and then there is an event, they change state, but then they come back and they stay there for a long time, and so on and so. Okay. So another mechanism. Yes. Yes.
And then you mentioned in the experiment you used helium.
Yes.
But you mentioned two states. So
yes.
Two S1 for it.
Yes.
So what are the three lambda type states in
yes.
the
I will explain that. Maybe I should have discussed that a bit more clearly. It will come later. So I will explain why you have a lambda structure if you have a J equal 1 to 1 transition. You cannot?
You cannot measure them, I mean they don't interact with light.
So you see this nice helium atom? To detect them you don't use light.
Okay.
You see? It knocks onto this detector, it emits an electron, you detect the electrons.
Okay. You said there is a transfer possible from the FP non-zero momentum to FP to the zero momentum in this ESCPT. So what kind of process is it? So does the atom get excited to the excited state
E
and then fall into the zero momentum state, or is it like a direct transfer?
No, there is no direct transfer in between the two the ground states, okay?
Okay, so excited and then fall.
Well, if it's related to what spontaneous emission does, you have to be excited to the excited state and go down. If you would want to detect them optically, this is still possible. This configuration is very related to the polarization of the light, okay? So you would say it's dark, so if I look at the fluorescence, then I don't see atoms, but nothing prevents me from shining a laser with another polarization coming from another direction, and in that case, they will scatter photons, okay? More questions?
For what this is used?
For fun. Yes?
How cold do you have to be that this starts working? So that's usually you have
to... Yeah.
Now and then you do more.
It's a very good question, actually.
Lower.
True.
And when do you start using that?
Yes. So you see that they evidenced that on the collimated beam, which was somewhat narrow in the momentum spread in the transverse direction, and in a MOT, which was also starting with a relatively cold temperature. The larger the momentum distribution you have at the beginning, the longer it will take to accumulate the atom in the dark state. Eventually, you will have only a very small fraction accumulated of the total number of atoms, because it takes a long time in these random processes to jump from one family to the other and eventually end up in the good family of state. Okay, so having atoms colder at the beginning is better, and you see that actually if you look at somewhat this numerical simulation of the process. Okay, that it starts building, and if the distribution would be even much broader, you see that takes time to. Well, you can anticipate that it will take time to put those atoms which are at very high momenta into the dark state. Okay, so let's proceed. So, it's not really used so far because it was studied as one of the methods to do subrecoil, okay? And people were really excited by trying to beat this limit and see whether they could increase the phase space density, they could produce BECs and stuff like this. So that's one of the motivations for using this. And this was a big part of the scientific activity of Claude Cohen-Tanouji by the end of his career somehow. He worked a lot on that, and he was the one who developed actually this theory, the Levy flight statistics and tools and stuff like this.
No,
because you see that to get the BEC, you need in addition somewhat a way to accumulate atoms at high densities locally. And with this mechanism, it only plays with momentum, but that doesn't do anything onto the density. So in the end, I don't know what the phase space density they had, probably higher than in a MOT or so, for sure, but still not enough to be to reach the BEC. Yes.
With the dimension in 1D, it's kind of if you do quantum work or so, you sometimes go to P equals zero. In 2D, you sometimes also, but there you much more rarely.
It's very inefficient.
It's like almost impossible to come back to P equals zero. So that's why actually the 3D pictures looks ugly, because actually a very small fraction of the total atom number is actually.
Yes. Yeah.
So in the end, in 3D, it's not so efficient.
No. We will see the same kind of thing with this this other mechanism, which is Raman cooling, which also is based on some kind of where there's a little bit of random processes at play, that the efficiency depends on the dimensionality. So the Raman transition, Raman cooling uses as a tool to manipulate the momentum of the atom. Okay. Counterpropagating Raman transitions. So this is a process where you shine two lasers in a counterpropagating configuration, okay? Which are both detuned largely from resonance, usually, okay? But whose frequency difference, omega 1 minus omega 2, okay, matches the energy difference between two states. This could be, for instance, two hyperfine states of a ground state of an alkali, okay? And this would be the D1 or the D2 line. So the process is the following. I have an atom initially in the state G1, okay, with a momentum P. It will absorb a photon in the wave, in the laser one, okay? And with that, its momentum changes to p plus h bar k1. Okay? And then it will re-emit in a stimulated way in the wave that goes opposite. So doing so, he actually recoils and gets a momentum kick in the same direction as the first one. Okay? So when I re-emit a photon here, I get kicked this way. So it ends up in this G2 state with a momentum which differs by h bar k1 minus h bar k2. So I can define this as a k effective, okay, which is k1 minus k2. And if you consider that those states have a tiny energy difference, because there are, for instance, hyperfine states of a ground state of rubidium with respect to this, which is an electronic transition, okay, they have roughly the same amplitude. So they differ by their sign, so the difference is somewhat close to twice the momentum of each of the two. And this process, if you write energy conservation, oh, sorry, somebody sends me a mail. This process also obeys a resonance condition which is set by conservation of energy. So it's doing the same as in the previous, the first lecture. You calculate the energy after the process and before. And this tells that you have pretty much alike in the one photon transition, okay, a resonance condition where the laser frequency is replaced by the difference between the frequencies of the two lasers. It has to match the difference in the energy between the two states. There is a Doppler shift which is related to kV, but where k is the k of the two photon process, okay, so 2kV. And there's a recoil term as well. So you see that this process, because of this Doppler shift, is actually velocity selective. Okay. So usually, stimulated Raman transition are performed with relatively large detuning, a few gigahertz away from the excited state, and so that one can completely neglect spontaneous emission. Okay. And one can show that this dynamic of this, say, free states reduces to an effective two-level atom, where at the coupling between the two states, through the path to the excited state still, okay, it leads to Rabi oscillation between the two states with a Rabi frequency that depends on the product of the Rabi frequency, single photon Rabi frequency, okay? And it's inversely proportional to the detuning. So what does that mean? Imagine I start with atom in the state G1, okay, with an RMS with sigma v or so, right, like this, okay, Gaussian distribution. And I just shine a Raman pulse, which I make a pi pulse. So it's a square pulse, constant intensity. And this time it adjusted such that it makes a pi pulse in this Rabi process for the atoms that are resonant. Okay? So in the momentum distribution, atoms which are resonant are completely transferred to the other state. And doing so, if I tune the resonance such that I speak to those guys, the atoms in the G2 state have received a 2 h bar k recoil, momentum kick. Okay. So you see that I can, you have here this line shape, which is the sinus cardinal, which corresponds to the excitation profile of a square pulse. So I can use that to selectively transfer a certain momentum class from one state to the other, with a width here that depends on the coupling. So the more intensity I put, the larger the fraction of atom I transfer, the shorter the pulse. On the contrary, if I want to be very selective, I make very long pulse with reduced intensity, and I can transfer a very small fraction of the atom. So the idea of the Raman cooling is the following. You do that basically in sequences of two steps. The first step is that you realize such a pi pulse that transfers one momentum class from one state to the other, okay? At a certain detuning, so you pick up in the velocity distribution which velocity you want to transfer. And this is what is illustrated here. So imagine I start with this initial distribution. I can basically dig here a hole in the G1 distribution. So this is blue is the distribution of G1, okay, before the pulse. This is the distribution after the pulse. You see that all those atoms are missing. they have been transferred in G2 with this momentum transfer that brings them closer to the center of the distribution. Wow, cool. So then I apply a pulse of repumper to bring the velocity selected atom back into the G1 state. So I always starting in G1. So I did the transfer to G2, but then those atoms that are transferred, I want to bring them back to G1. So the distribution in G1 is simply basically the sum of the two. And you see that, okay, I do not say what happens to this spontaneous photon, well, if it messed up or not the velocity distribution. Here, assume that it does that without changing the velocity distribution. I simply have the sum of the two distributions. Okay, so you see that I took part of the momentum distribution and I brought it back, brought it closer to zero. And the idea of the Raman cooling is to apply such a sequence, a pulse, a repumping pulse, and so on and so on and so, with different Raman frequency difference, so that I will address different velocity classes successively in order to pile them up close to zero. Okay? So this is a little illustration where this is what I would look if I would do three square pulses with the identical Rabi frequency, so relatively broad, but what would change the detuning from addressing atoms which have a detuning of 6 times the recoil the recoil velocity, okay? 4 times, 2 times. And this is what happens after the first pulse. I take this and I put it here. The second pulse, I take whatever was there. And the third pulse, I take whatever was here, ding. And you see that somewhat, with this sequence of three pulses, I have more atoms close to zero, okay? Well, this is a very crude, simple calculation with a silly, not optimized parameters. You can imagine that indeed, you can do that very efficiently if, for instance, first, you do that in both directions, okay? So that you also bring those guys close to the center. And if you somewhat tailor a little bit the sequence by adapting the pulse shape, the Rabi frequency you use, and the detunings, okay? So how in this scheme can we use different pulse shapes to improve the velocity selectivity? Somewhat, you could imagine that the ideal case would be a case where I do an excitation profile which is like a rectangular. All the atoms that are there, I put there, but I don't touch to the others, and then I jump to the velocity class which is shifted, and I do that such that none of the consecutive pulses do affect the atoms that I have already transferred. Okay, and if you have these simple square pulses, this excitation profile is this sinus cardinal, and you have those stupid ripples that will be a little bit messy, that will compromise the efficiency of the process. So an idea is to shape the pulse to have a better defined excitation profile, not quite rectangular, okay, but somewhat with less ripples, and this is what people have using those pulses called Blackman pulses. So it's a pulse where you increase slowly the Rabi frequency up to 1, and then you decrease. And the excitation, the transition priority, does not have this ripples that the square pulse has, okay? It's somewhat better defined in the momentum space to which atoms you are actually speaking to. And this is exactly this kind of pulse shapes that have been used in optimized pulse sequences where you see a representation of the successive pulses with their excitation profile at different detunings. So you start there, bing, bong, bing, bong, bing, bong, bing, bong. And when the atoms get closer, then you have less atoms to the side, and then you bring them and so. And in the end, note that you also reduce the Rabi frequency such that you speak to the excitation profile gets narrower and addresses narrower and narrower part of the velocity distribution as a function of its narrowing somehow, okay? And you make such that you keep the excitation here for the velocity class zero minimum, okay? And this was implemented for the first time in 1D by Mark Kasevich and Steve Chu in 92, and they could reach sub-recoil velocity residual distribution of 0.2 V recoil. Okay? You can extend this to 2D, but in 2D you see that things are somewhat less efficient, that the velocity distribution is of the order of the recoil velocity or even larger. And these are pictures of those papers where they have studied 2D and 3D cases. Okay. I said, okay, we have, yes?
So when you are picking atoms from certain velocity class and piling them up
yes.
to zero, you're disturbing the Maxwell Boltzmann distribution, so there must be some effective thermalization rate where atoms would want to again fall back into distribution.
May not. If there is not enough collision, no mechanism for redistributing the energy, they stay in their velocity class, okay?
So there is no dissipation
for this process. No, actually, here, if you neglect completely spontaneous emission from the ground state, from the excited state, okay? This is what we try to be in this regime with this Raman process, okay? So there is no dissipation somehow. The velocity is taken by the exchange of photons with the two beams, okay? It's a conservative process in terms of energy if you consider the atom and the fields from the two waves. But it's a coherent process, and when the atoms have changed velocity, if there is nothing to make them thermalize, they remain with this velocity. Does that respond to your question? So I said, somewhat, this sinus cardinal profile is a little bit ugly with its ripples, and it will make a mess. But is it really true that it's a bad choice? Somewhat, if I choose properly the detuning and the Rabi frequency, I can make such that the V equals zero, which corresponds to one of the zero of this sinus cardinal. Okay? In the previous line shape I showed, this goes slowly down, but doesn't go to zero. Whereas here, it's really a zero. So then they used this, but they went back to square pulses and carefully making such that in the choice they have in the sequence of the Rabi coupling and detuning, they would make such that there is always a zero at V equals zero of excitation. And doing so, they could do better and reach even lower temperature in 1D and also in 2D. Okay. Just a comment. I cheated a bit here because, you know, there is this process of repumping, which is based on a spontaneous emission, and the spontaneous emission will make a random transfer of momentum in a direction or in another. But this Raman process is something that will tend to accumulate atoms in zero. So if they try to escape, they will be also coming back somehow. Okay? But it's true that it's something that limits the efficiency of the process, that you have to use this repumping process. Okay, one can use the same tools of this Raman transitions to implement Raman cooling, but in an optical lattice. This was done for neutral atoms, but also for ions. I will come to that later. So here you start with cold atom that you have prepared in a mott and molasses to temperature a few microkelvin or so. And you put them in a spin polarized state. You do that by optical pumping. And this, for instance, here is F equal 3, MF equal 3 state of a cesium atom. Okay? So the atom will occupy the many different wells allowed in the different vibrational states. And in typical optical lattices, you have a vibrational frequency in the kilohertz, tens of kilohertz, hundreds of kilohertz range. And the basic idea of this Raman sideband cooling is the following. You apply a magnetic field that will lift the degeneracy between transitions, between the two different MF states in the F equal 3 state. Okay? So if I have no Zeeman splitting, I have this structure with the vibrational state in MF equal 3, and I have the same at the same energy in F equal 2. Okay? But if I apply a well-chosen magnetic field, I can leave the degeneracy, so I will have a difference in the energy of the bottom state. Okay? And I choose this very specific magnetic field for which I put in coincidence the zero state of the MF equal plus 2 state, okay, with the one state of the MF equal plus 3. Why is that? Because then I will use this is explained maybe in the next slide. Yeah, okay. I will implement a cooling cycle in which I will use a random pulse which has a well-chosen polarization. It has to induce a pi sigma plus transition. So starting with an atom which is in the F equal 3 state, MF equal 3, in a vibration level, say, nu, so here, for instance, 1, okay? I will have this Raman transition that will bring me to the state F equal 3, MF equal plus 2, but with a lower vibrational number different by 1, okay? And then I have to apply a repumping pulse tuned there to bring the atom back into the MF equal plus 3 state. So with an important thing I will explain later is that if the atoms are really tightly bound, the scattered photon that I have here through the optical process, okay, do not change the vibrational state. So the atom initially, which I have transferred here, say in the zero state, they will decay in the zero state. So one cycle is I decrease by one at each pulse and repumping pulse the quantum number associated to the vibrational state. Okay, so at the end of the cycle, they have lost one quantum of vibration. And I repeat that, and eventually I accumulate them in the ground state. So what is the, how can one understand that this decay happens preferentially without changing the vibrational state? This is true if we are in the so-called Lambda decay regime. So quite generally, the probability for an atom which is in a state with energy E and a vibrational state Nx, okay, to decay in other states which differ in their vibrational quantum number is related to the coupling between the two states through the special part of the dipole interaction. Okay? So this is the matrix element that tells what is the probability for an atom to decay from that state there, in a different momentum, a vibrational state. So if I am interested in this, I have to basically understand how this probability behaves for different nx prime and n prime and n. So in this harmonic oscillator, the spatial extension of the state n scales roughly like square root of n times the extension of the ground state, okay? So if I have small nx, so I am already in the lowest energy state, this extension is of the order of a naught, okay? So that kr, which is here, okay, is of the order of ka0, where zero is the ground state extension. This writes like this, okay, somewhat. And this is this Lambda decay parameter. And note that if I choose omega very large enough, I can make this parameter smaller than one, okay, which means that kr will be smaller than one. Atoms will be very confined to spatial extent which are way below the wavelength of the light, which sets the spacing of the lattice. And in this regime of tight confinements, I can simply consider that kr being very small to 1, which corresponds to this Lambda decay parameter very small to 1, I can make this development of exponential akx, okay? And keep only the zero order, the first order. And x here is the position operator, so it's related to a linear combination of increase or decrease the vibrational quantum number. So in the end, if I plug this into that, I have this one. So those two states are orthogonal, okay? So if the nx and n prime x are different, then this is zero, and one if they're the same, so it's a delta. And then this term here, which is a sum of a dagger and a, gives coupling to from nx to n prime x plus one. Enfin, this is a delta, okay? So if nx prime is nx minus one or plus one, and then it's possible, otherwise it's not, okay? So basically, being here, you go there, or there, or there. But here, you see that this probability here is set by this lambda parameter, which is very small, okay? So this coupling is predominant in what dominates is the return to the ground state without any change of the vibrational state, okay? So this is key for the mechanism that you have this, that when you repump, you have removed one quantum, and you don't want that when you repump, you spoil what you have done. Note that this method of Raman sideband pooling was employed way before implementing the method with neutral atom in ion traps. So here it's even more simple. This is really an electronic transition. You tune your laser on the right sideband, which is here, okay? So you promote the atom to the excited state by taking one vibrational quantum of energy. And when they decay, because of this lambda, if they are in this lambda decay regime, they decay while keeping the same vibrational state. So that in the end, at each fluorescence emission fluorescence cycle, they lose one quantum of energy and they repeat that, and boom, they are all in the ground state. Okay, let's go back to the case of our neutral atoms. So we can do a sequence of such cooling cycles to reduce the vibration quantum number from any value to the ground state. And note that if the atoms are in the vibrational ground state, they are in the dark state because the Raman coupling can only decrease by one the vibrational quantum number. So if I am at zero, but there is no minus one. So I'm sitting there and it's a dark state. Both with respect to the Raman coupling, but also to the optical pumping affecting only atom in the F equal 2 and F equal plus 2 state. So this was implemented in this paper here in 1998 in a 1D lattice. So they had a cesium atom trapped in a single, in a 1D lattice, and they could still reach 3D temperatures, despite that here it's a 1D mechanism. Quite cold, so 2.8 microkelvin, with 80% of the atom in the vibrational ground state, at least well in the steepest direction. And the fact that they would cool only in 1D and they would have a 3D temperature low is that in this trap, because there are collisions, energy redistributes between the different degrees of freedom. And you cool the axial direction, but then you see that the radial direction cools down as well due to this redistribution of energy through the collisions. Because in the optical lattice, then you know you have a very strong confinement. So here you have collisions now actually at play. They could reach phase space density as low as 1/180, okay, and relatively high densities, okay. So this is not quite what is needed to reach BEC somehow, but it's already 4 or 5 orders of magnitude better than with standard MOT and molasses methods. This was extended to 2D and 3D lattices, and atoms have been put in the ground vibrational state in two directions and three directions. They could reach sub-recoil temperatures, or recoil temperature somehow. And the phase space densities, which were not quite enough to reach BEC, but somewhat better. Interesting is that in this method, once the atom are in this ground state of the vibrational of the ground vibrational state, you would release them from the lattice, okay, and then you make a time of flight measurement to determine what the temperature is. And you have a possibility to adiabatically cool the atom by before releasing from the trap, decompress, deconfine, okay? And by decreasing the lattice depth, you see that you start with this initial temperature and you end up with this final temperature. So you know you have a final temperature which is lower than the initial temperature. So if you are at 1 micro K, then you end up at 200 and something 90 nanokelvin. This is with this adiabatic release from the lattice. This method was in a quite recent paper used to actually reach BEC with this Raman sideband cooling. This was done in a 2D lattice. And it involved this Raman degenerate cooling, but with tricks, cycles of cloud compression to increase the density. Well, I don't want to enter into the detail, but I think it's a very neat paper. You can look into that. And they could show that they would reach BEC with a relatively small number of atoms, but in only 300 milliseconds using this method. So you have to understand that those methods were the ones that people pursued like crazy, trying to reach BEC. Okay? And at some point, somebody did the BEC in a different way. We will see later. But you know, this guy, Vuletic, who's the leader of this team, was the one here who did the first 1D lattice experiment. So this was in 1998, and somewhat he didn't give up, you know. 20 years after, I did it with this Raman degenerate cooling. Wow, great. Yes?
There were really 300 milliseconds from the wiper, so from the
Spencers
to the
BC? No, I don't think so. I think it's more like the different steps of compression, cycles, yeah. Conversion, not. Yeah, so you trap and so on. Okay, is that okay? Well, cool. Gray molasses now. You know, it's like it's a zoology of all laser cooling methods, you know. There are many. Gray molasses. You like gray molasses. So the idea is to somewhat combine dark states, which make that atoms are somewhat immune to the spontaneous emission, and Sisyphus-like cooling. And this can be done if I use this model transition, which is this J equal 1 to 1 transition, for which there is a dark state, okay? And maybe I should have explained that much earlier, but why is it such, okay? If I have two counterpropagating beams with linear or circular polarizations, couplings allowed are the ones that do change this MF state by plus or minus 1, okay? In this J equal 1 to 1 transition, this Clebsch-Gordan coefficient between the 0 to 0 state is actually 0. Okay? So an atom that is here cannot decay there. It decays here or there. Okay? But if an atom is initially in 0, it will absorb a photon from these waves with sigma plus or with sigma minus. It will eventually go back and then go again. Okay? But if it falls here, then it stays there. And this is this lambda scheme that you can use. So if you have circular polarization, polarization, you have this J equal 1 to 1 transition. After a few fluorescent cycles, the atom are somewhat in those two minus 1 and plus 1 state. And everything happens in this lambda scheme. Okay. So we can use this lambda model with this transition and those polarizations and consider only out of those six states, these three states. Which we have already seen before. Okay, in this gray molasses, I use a configuration of polarization which is not sigma plus, sigma minus, not lin per lin. This is called lin theta lin. Okay? What is that? I have two counterpropagating laser beams, okay, with linear polarization, but they make an angle, which is not zero and not pi over two, an angle, which is called theta. Then, what would then the total electric field look like in such a polarization configuration? So I calculate the total electric field by considering the interference, the sum of the two components that have different k directions, okay? And each of them has this epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, which is this linear polarization with an angle theta. So epsilon 1 decomposes on epsilon x, y with this linear combination, epsilon 2, this one. So this is this picture where E1 is tilted by minus theta over 2 with respect to y, okay? And E2 is by the opposite angle. Okay, so I have those two polarization, and this is my y-axis. Okay. So if I do a little bit of algebra, blah, 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 I can show that this total polarization electric field, the z-dependent, which is here, writes as this, where epsilon plus and epsilon minus are the vectors corresponding to sigma plus and sigma minus polarization. So this can be understood as a superposition of two sigma plus and sigma minus polarizations with amplitudes that are actually standing waves. You see, this is a cosine, and this is a cosine, but standing waves which are slightly shifted by plus or minus theta over 2 with respect to each other. So I have two standing waves of sigma plus and sigma minus polarization, which are slightly shifted with respect to each other. Since those two polarizations, sigma plus and sigma minus, are orthogonal, if I want to calculate what is the intensity, I just take the intensity of this and the intensity of that, I sum. And doing so, I find that I have a modulated intensity with this modulation at 2kz, and depending on this angle, cosine theta. So if I want this modulation of the intensity in this lean, theta lean situation, I shall not basically take theta equal pi over 2, which is the lean Perplin configuration. There are orthogonal polarization. There is no intensity modulation. Since they have orthogonal polarization, when I sum them, I have no modulation. So here, in this lean theta lean configuration, intensity is modulated with this spatial period, which is lambda over 2. Okay? So we will write the intensity as E squared over 2 times this dz, which is this expression, which is the modulation of the intensity. Okay? So I have two phase-shifted standing waves and a modulation of the intensity. This is what the laser coupling looks like now. So I consider this sigma plus, sigma minus transition in this lambda system, okay? And I consider this amplitude, which is related to the component of the electric field along this sigma plus and sigma minus, which are z-dependent, which are modulated with z, okay? Which are those standing waves. So this, this coupling writes like this. And then the same story. I can find a superposition of the two states G1 and G2 with appropriate weights that are respectively a non-coupled state and a coupled state. So this one is a dark state for this interaction. Okay? So you see that it's a linear combination of the two ground states with amplitudes here that do depend on the position. So it's a non-coupled state that depends on Z. Okay. So at each z position, I have a coupled state and another coupled state, which writes like this. And the laser coupling, since this is the non-coupled state, reduces to simply the coupling of the coupling state to the excited state. Okay. With this omega z being omega 1 times this modulation function d. Okay, so we have a dark state, where it's a lambda system, there's a dark state, and this configuration of polarization, this dark state, depends on Z, and it has a modulation. So now we will consider the weak excitation regime. So we take the saturation parameter small, okay? And we will use a detuning which will be positive, okay? So I set this to this lambda configuration, but I choose the laser such that they are out of resonance, slightly detuned and blue detuned. Right? In this, given that this coupled state, okay, is coupled to the light, okay, it acquires a light shift, which is as usual given by delta over 2 times the saturation parameter. And here the saturation parameter is related to the intensity, okay? So it depends on Z. So the light shift is modulated for this coupled state with this D function. This delta prime here is the strength here, and it's independent of Z. And it also acquires a radiative decay rate, gamma prime, which is given by gamma over 2 S, which is also modulated with Z by this function D, okay? And as the non-coupled state is not coupled to the state, bah, it has no decay and it has no shift. So this is what it looks like then. Since I chose the detuning to be positive, I have the coupled state which has a light shift which is modulated with the potential, the position, and I have the non-coupled state which is not shifted and stable. And, voilà. The light shift here, proportional to delta dz, is modulated with this special period lambda over 2. So now, consider that I have an atom, which by chance, I have prepared in this dark state, at the position z equals 0, okay? This is the initial position, it's in dark state, and it moves at a velocity v. At a later time, when it's not is not anymore at z equals 0, it's position z1, okay? He's still in this dark state z0, but this is no longer a dark state at position z1, because the dark state at position z1 is psi non-coupled z1, which doesn't have the same expression as psi not psi 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 non-coupled zero z0. Do you understand? So I have a dark state at position, but if I move position and I stay in the state, I'm not no longer in the dark state because this dark state depends on the position. So one can see that, one can imagine that since this state is no longer a dark state, it basically gets contaminated by the coupled state z1. I can write this non-coupled state at position z1 as a superposition of the non-coupled state at z1 plus the coupled state at z1. So part of this wave function is now coupled to the light. And thus it acquires a radiative lifetime and it can decay and it can scatter photons and so on. So in this little picture here, you have this kind of Sisyphus cooling where atoms here moving, as they are no longer in the real dark state somewhat, you know, they basically couple to the coupled state. And there they climb the hill and they have a chance to have a fluorescence that might bring them down to the non-coupled state, okay? So you have here Sisyphus-like cooling that occurs in between this non-coupled state and the coupled state. Oh, so how can I understand this, you know, coupling here and the transfer from one state to the other? You can look at what is the evolution of the wave function. If you start by say with an atom in a dark state psi non-coupled z0, okay? And we will write the state, psi, in general, in this basis of the non-coupled and coupled state, which depends on z, okay? So the evolution is given by the psi is a linear superposition of those two states with weights a and b, okay? And with z, which actually is a time-dependent quantity, because z is vt, the atom is moving, okay? So basis of state is changing with time. So if I start with an atom in t equals 0, which has a position z equals 0, z0, okay, in the dark state, so it's corresponding to having a equal 1 and b equals 0, okay? And then I can calculate what the evolution of this quantum state is by simply solving the Schrödinger equation, okay? And taking into account this V coupling with this shape. So if I do so, I derivate the wave function. Not only I have to derivate A and B, but also psi, because psi depends on Z and depends on T. Okay? So I have in this derivative, the derivative of the weights of A and B, okay, with respect to the wave function, but also A times the derivative of NC and C, okay, psi NC and psi C, which I can write d over dt is d over dz times v, okay? So this is a v dependent, so I derivate over z. And so this is my Schrödinger equation, okay? Contains this, and this V upside. If I project over the state psi c, actually we get the rate of increase of B. Okay, so this tells us at which rate the atom will be leaving the dark state. It starts in the dark state perfectly with A equal 1, and evolving and moving, it's evolving in a superposition of the coupled and non-coupled state at this very new position. And this is the rate at which this happens. And basically the state is contaminated and the fraction of the wave function goes to the coupled state. Well, you can use expressions of psi nc and psi c to calculate this, and you find this term where you see that the coupling is inversely proportional to this dz, the modulation of the intensity. Okay, so it's proportional to the velocity and inversely proportional to d. So if I restrict the development to very short times and slow velocity, okay, A remains basically close to 1, and B increases well, I forgot the T, but linearly with V and so this is what the wave function looks like, and this is the contamination that the state acquires on the coupled state. So this is some kind of coupling from this state to the coupled state, and you see that it's proportional to V. So if the atom is not moving, it's not coupled, it's a dark state. So it's what people call a motional coupling. It's really related to the fact that the atom move and that the wave function basically evolves. The non-coupled and coupled state wave function do evolve with time because they depend on the position. Interesting is that this coupling here is actually maximum when the dz is minimum. So the contamination will get larger when the atom is close to the minimum of the night shift of the coupled state. Okay, so this is basically where it will be more efficiently transferred to the coupled state. And then it climbs the hill, and the rate at which you will scatter photon here is maximum where it's at the top, because this is at the top where both light shifts and decay rates are maximum. Okay, so the atom is preferentially transferred here to the coupled state, or contaminated to the coupled state here, and preferentially scatters the photon at the top. So this is what makes that you have this Sisyphus cooling. Okay. Okay. So I will not give you the total algebra how to calculate this force, but this is the expression that one finds. And interesting is that this force is really peculiar because it's not a friction force. It scales like V to the power 3. Okay? So you have this kind of hyperbolic behavior. And you have this prefactor here that actually depends on the choice of the angle. So the force depends on this angle. And you see that, for instance, if I select pi over 2, then there is no force since there is no light shift modulation. People have calculated what is the time evolution of the momentum distribution by quantizing the momentum, okay, doing Monte Carlo simulation of the atom in this gray molasses. And it's really interesting because what sees is that you start with a flat momentum distribution, okay, and after some time you Sisyphus cooling is at play, okay, and you prepare a velocity distribution that is much narrower. But if you leave time go, then you will accumulate atom in this dark state, and you are back to something like looks like this VSCPT cooling double peak structure. Okay. So this was demonstrated in the 90s or so, observing sub-Doppler cooling in J equals zero, J to J minus 1. So J to J or J to J minus 1 are configurations of angular momentum for which you have dark states. and they saw that with a blue detuning. Okay, this was fancy somehow, because people were used to red detuned molasses. I go to the blue and it's cooling. What is it? And they could do freely cooling in a 4B molasses tuned on this F equal 3 to F equal 2 transition of cesium. And later, in a 6B molasses in the group of Christophe Salomon, I think, they reached a temperature as low as 1 microkelvin also with cesium using this method in a 3D. There are couple side effects. Somewhat the temperature deviates from the theory when you go to large detuning, and this is related to the fact that when you detune to the blue of the 3-2 transition, at some point you become close to the 3-3, and then you have additional coupling and parasitic excitation to the upper state, and also you have temperature density effects. I mean density, the temperature depends on density, also related to this photon multiple scattering that would make this kind of scaling with a fraction of micro k per 10 to the 10 atom per centimeter cube. There were more recent experimental demonstrations of this blue detuned molasses in the recent years, because they gained a renewed interest for cooling very peculiar atoms like potassium and lithium, which are a little bit pathological. And one of the difficulties with those atoms is that they have actually a fairly small, of only a few gamma typically, and eventually even inverted, hyperfine structure. And this basically compromises the efficiency of red detuned sub-Doppler cooling. When you want to go to large detuning, paf, you meet a state through which you have parasitic excitation. So you cannot reach so sub-Doppler temperatures. And so the idea was to implement this gray molasses. And you see that when you go to the blue, eventually, if you choose correctly the state, you can detune. And the more you detune, there are no parasitic states there. Okay, so the situation is different from being in the red. And you can also use, for instance, if you use those alkali atoms, do not use the D2 line, but more the D1 line, which has less hyperfine states, and also hyperfine states which are somewhat better separated. So this was implemented in 2012 here to cool potassium 40 atom to somewhat lower temperature than what people could achieve using a standard laser cooling techniques at that time. And I have more examples of implementation of this with references here you can look at if you're interested in a lithium 7, for instance, and in a potassium 39. You know this guy? He was a PhD student of this guy. They could get temperature then as low as 6 micro K, so it's not very far from, you know, the limit of sub-Doppler cooling. And interesting, they saw that looking at the temperature as a function of the detuning with respect to the Raman resonance. So you have this configuration of two beams, okay? And you can play at will with the relative detunings of the cooling beam and repumping beam, say, okay? In whatever I showed you, the two they would match, okay? So their frequency difference would match this basically hyperfine, this hyperfine transition, which means that those two arrows go to the same point here, okay? But in the experiment, you can play at will and change that. And what you see is that you have a really narrow minimum in this temperature that you measure when you are exactly at this fulfilling this Raman condition, like that the frequency difference between the two beams really match this frequency difference between the two hyperfine states. And note that here, the dark state is actually a linear combination of the two hyperfine states. Okay? So people have used that for these pathological atoms I mentioned, lithium, potassium, but somewhat also with rubidium, for which Sisyphus cooling works perfectly well, and also on the D2 line, because the D2 line is not so pathological, are large light shifts. So even if you're on the 2-2-2 transition, and you go a little bit to the blue, and you go a little bit away from the blue, you are still far from F3 equal 3, and it's fine, okay? And here again, they could observe in the temperature relatively sharp minimum here that corresponds to this Raman condition met. Temperatures were something like 4 micro K. So somewhat not so different from sub-Doppler cooling with Sisyphus cooling or sigma plus sigma minus cooling on the red of the F prime equal free transition. But here there is a gain of about an order of magnitude in the phase space density with respect to the ordinary sub-Doppler cooling. And this is related to the fact that the atom being in the dark state, I can also have higher densities. Okay. Voilà. So I think that's all. I had some reference and reviews to give as advice, but I will fill that, and you will probably have them. But there are many papers that I mentioned across the lecture, so you can read them if you're interested. The references are there. So if you have questions. No. Okay. Here you see that the force for very high velocities goes to zero. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So there is a certain frequency velocity range over which this works, and you see that this velocity range corresponds to Doppler shift that are way below gamma. Okay. So this force is far less effective than Doppler cooling, for instance, but not very different from the typical. I think capture range of sub-Doppler over sub-Doppler mechanisms. As for the V over free, well, I don't remember, but you know, it's related to the rate at which this transfer happens and the quantity of energy that you remove, which somewhat depend on the for each velocity. I mean, the fraction of the hill. Because this simple picture is for a given velocity, okay, that you couple here and you do this spontaneous emission there, okay. But you can also do partly. I climb part of the hill, okay. So I have a loss of energy here, which is only related to a fraction of that, which depends on my velocity somewhat. Because after a certain time, I have a certain position, so I have a certain energy, but this depends on my velocity. And at that time, I do a transfer. So this rate, this energy transfer, is also something like velocity dependent. Okay. So this probably explains that in the end, the velocity is not linear in V. Well, if you want details, I guess you have to read this paper. I do not remember exactly what the arguments were, but yes.
No,
but somewhat pretty much like what happens in Sisyphus cooling. At the lowest velocities, atoms do not move, actually. They get trapped into the wells here, okay? So they get localized and they stop moving and they oscillate in those wells. But there is no mechanism that actually brings the density to something higher. This is a good point. You can go and see this paper to have details. Obviously, if you have somewhat the same temperature about and you gain in the phase space density, it means that you know you have a better density, so the cloud is somewhat smaller. But I do not remember exactly what the parameters are. But these are not super big densities. We are still with typical mode densities, because it's only a modest increase. You know, phase density in the molasses is 10 to minus 5, 10 to minus 6, so here it's a factor 10, so it's not much.
Regarding this question, you can perform gray molasses in a dipole trap, so this is possible. Not quite recent paper came out that showed this. So you can have your trap, and you can also cool at the same time.
Yes. True. Many of the laser cooling techniques are somewhat compatible with being in traps. Depends on what the trap is, what is the light shift it produces to the lines, and so. But people use, for instance, Doppler cooling in magnetic traps or optical traps. Okay, and this can be combined with trapping force as well. Yeah. Ah, why is gray? Because the atom being somewhat predominantly during their time in this dark state, okay, they scatter less photons. So it's not a bright molasses. If you look with your viewer, if you make fluorescence on the camera, you will have far less fluorescence. But it's not completely dark because there is still scattering processes at play, okay? And that's the reason why people call that gray molasses. It's not quite dark, it's a bit gray. Okay, bon, that's enough for today, I think.